Hello and welcome to those who have already joined us. We will wait a few moments for the last participants to log in. We will now begin. Hello and welcome. I'm delighted to welcome you to this webinar entitled How Evaluate the Performance of Cosmetic Products. I'm Charlotte Tournier. I'm in charge of the SenseNet France entity and product testing expert. I will be your host for the whole session. Don't hesitate to ask me questions via the chat in the bottom right corner of your screen. I will answer them by email shortly after this webinar. At the end of the session, you will find my contact details and a link to our website where you can book a free exchange session with one of our experts to discuss in more detail your olfactory analysis needs. We will start by introducing the SenseNet Group. Then I will remind you of some figures concerning the cosmetics market. We will then get to the heart of the matter by answering the question of why and how to measure the odor of cosmetic products. Finally, I will detail five case studies representing different challenges of olfactory analysis on various cosmetics products. In 2018, the SenseNet brand was created as part of the Odonet group, dedicated exclusively to the control of odors in products and materials. Odonet is the world's largest odor control consultancy with almost 40 years of experience with practical knowledge from thousands of studies in all relevant sectors. Odonet and SenseNet have offices and laboratories in Europe, India, and Brazil, as well as consultants and experts in odor measurement in all their centers. SenseNet helps its clients to improve sensory attributes of their consumer products and materials, supporting product development and claim substantiations by applying sensory expertise and molecular aroma analysis. Unravel and understand the molecular origins and composition of the sensory aroma and make sense of sensory. The cosmetics market is a high-growth sector that represented 264 billion euros in 2017, according to figures from Cosmetics Europe's magazine. Some markets, such as Asia, have strongly emerged in recent years, but Europe remains a major player in this sector. Indeed, in Europe, France is a leader in the field of cosmetic products, while Germany has a considerable turnover in hygiene products. Among the most important sectors of the cosmetics market in Europe, we find cosmetic care in the first position, followed by body care, hair care, perfumes, and finally makeup. This sector has grown in part because of the attention that manufacturers pay to the needs, requirements, and experience of consumers. In this consumer experience, olfactory perceptions play an important role. Whether the desire is to mask body odors, often associated with a lack of hygiene, or to optimize the properties of a perfume, the evaluation of a product's olfactory performance becomes essential. Olfactory measurements are of interest at every stage of product development. At the innovation stage, to identify market opportunities and understand consumer preferences, in R&D to select and or validate prototypes, at the industrialization stage to select raw materials or to optimize production steps, And finally, at the marketing stage to launch an innovation or validation of claim. So now, how do we measure odors? Two steps are important in defining an experimental plan for odor assessments, sampling and then analysis. Sampling first is a crucial step. It will depend on the product segment, the product itself, and the objective of the study. In many cases, it is important that the test conditions are as close as possible to the actual use of the product by consumer. For some product segments, dedicated standards have been developed. This is the case for deodorant products whose efficacy tests are described in the ISTM 1207. But for products without associated standards, individualized sampling adapted to the product or material to be tested should be developed and implemented. We'll see some examples of sampling method in case studies. The analysis can be sensory and or molecular. A characteristic measurement is the odor threshold concentration, which is by definition the concentration where an odor can be detected with a probability of 50%. For the measurement of odor concentration, the olfactometry method is used worldwide according to EN 13725. An olfactometer comprises a sophisticated system that dilutes odor samples with natural air and presents them to a panel for detection. The odor concentration provides a quantified value of the odor level of a sample and is expressed in odor units. This parameter is useful for describing the olfactory impact of products. It can be used to measure odor reduction or longevity fragrances. However, odor concentration does not correlate directly with odor perception. Opening a product container or applying a product to the skin releases volatile compounds which can often be perceived instantly. In order to assess the odor in a reproducible manner, the parameters measured are then intensity and hedonic tone. It is a challenging task to determine these parameters over an absolute scale, since intensity and hedonic tone cannot be judged independently. Consumers tend to underestimate the intensity of the odor when it is pleasant and overestimate it when it is related to a bad odor. The standardization of such measurement is very important. VDA 3882 allows the evaluation of intensity on a 7-point scale by answering the question, how strong is the odor? While the evaluation of hedonic tone can be made by answering the question, is the odor pleasant? Depending on the information required, this can be done with experts or with representative panels. In addition to the intensity and hedonic tone, it is also possible to work on the description of the odor. This requires extensive training of the panelist. SenseNet has therefore developed an internal methodology to train panelists and evaluate the description of odors according to a reference system containing around 30 references from different chemical and olfactory families. Sometimes molecular measurements can be complementary and indispensable. Mass spectroscopy can be coupled with the human nose as a complementary detector. This method is called GC sniffing or GCO olfaction. The combination of the chemical identification of molecules by GC MSTOF with their perceived odor allows a detailed understanding of the origin of odors present in the airspace of the product. To learn more about this technique, please register for my colleague Carmen Villatoro's webinar entitled Insight into GC Sniffing Analysis, Case Studies and Applications. The combination of these two types of analysis, molecular and sensory, can be used to meet a variety of study objectives. such as how is my product perceived, what are its sensory and olfactory properties, how is my product on the market, what test should I set up to claim a persistence time or efficacy in reducing odors, how can I ensure the sensory quality of my products and search for the origin of possible olfactory defaults. We will then illustrate this example of studies through case studies on different cosmetics products. The first case study concerns fragrances. The challenge for our client was to determine the kinetics of long-lasting of fragrances formulated with a different solvent in order to offer the cosmetic industry an alternative to alcoholic solvents while maintaining the performance of the fragrance. The following sampling protocol was implemented. 3 samples of fragrances with different solvent composition were tested on a support mimicking the physical properties of the skin, the vitroskin. An internally developed tool, the scent sampler, was used to collect the headspace in a Nalofan bag. Nalofan is a material recommended by the EN13725 as it limits the interaction between the sample and the containing and offers enough impermeability until analysis. Measurements of odor concentration according to EN13725 at different measurement times over 8 hours then made it possible to draw the olfactory decay curve of the fragrances over time. Before giving an overview of the results obtained, I suggest you watch a video illustrating the sampling protocol followed. The vitroskin is in the form of a moisturizing sheet. Sections are to be cut out in the desired format. The products are applied according to a rigorously identical process. Here, the laboratory technician applies 3 sprays on the entire surface, then spreads the product evenly with his fingers. The scent sampler is then positioned to collect the headspace by flushing the surface of the vitroskin. It is important that the flow, temperatures, and humidity conditions are controlled. At the outlet of the scent sampler, the gas sample is collected in an allophane bag. The results obtained following this experimental plan are presented on this slide according to 2 graphs. On the graph on the left, we observe the decay curves of the 3 samples whose solvent compositions varies. On the graph on the right, the histograms represent the percentage of odor remaining after each measuring point. Under the study conditions, solvent 2 therefore, has a slower long-lasting kinetics with a higher odor concentration after 8 hours of application on vitroskin. The following case study is based on hair products. Indeed, certain hair products intended for professionals such as hair coloring or straightening products can emit unpleasant odors. In order to fully understand the molecular origin of the odors perceived during the use of this product, a client asked us to first perform GC sniffing analysis on 3 raw formulas. This result should then enable the client to develop a perfume capable of masking the odorous molecules highlighted during this first stage. The products were therefore introduced in a microchamber. The microchambers are stainless steel containers upstream of the gas chromatography stage, allowing the headspace of liquid or solid sample to be collected by flushing. The microchambers can also be heated to a temperature between 25 and 250 degrees. For this case study, the set point was set at 30 degrees. Analysis by GC sniffing is then carried out. Chemical compounds are identified and quantified by mass spectrometry, while an olfactory description of this molecule is made by an operator if they are odorous. The link between olfactory perception and chemical identity is made according to the retention time. A table gathering this information is then established. An extract of such a table is presented opposite. An olfactory profile can be established based on perceived odors. In our case study, we can see that the three raw formulas have different sensory and molecular profiles. Sample 8 presents a sulfur note due to the presence of diethyl sulfide. Sample 10 has fewer sulfur notes, but more pungent notes due to the presence of nitrogen compounds. The hair strands are first shampooed according to a very precise protocol. The shampoo time, the flow rate, and the temperature of the rinse water are controlled. A precise amount of product is weighed and applied to the hair strand. The scent sampler is again used to collect the headspace. The prepared bag can then be presented to the panelist for sensory evaluation. The bag is presented via a tool called PureSniff, which allows a standardized presentation of the sample. The presentation rate and presentation time are the same for all panelists. The results below show the comparison of sensory evaluation by 8 trained panelists of one of the previously studied raw formulas against the same raw formula with 2 different fragrances. The graph on this slide highlights the results on the parameters hedonic tone and odor description. The fragrances significantly improve the hedonic perception of the product. Perfume 1 has mainly floral notes and seems to mask the sulfur notes more. The following case also involves hair products. The challenge was to demonstrate that the application of a nutritive oil after shampoo increases the long-lasting of the shampoo perfume on the hair. To do this, a discriminative analysis, the triangular method, was performed by direct evaluation of styling hairs with natural hair. Four styling heads were prepared, two with only the shampoo and two with the shampoo followed by the application of the nutritive oil. Styling heads were presented 24 hours after their preparation in random triads to 15 panelists with a duplicate. The panelists were asked to identify the styling head that was different from the other two. Thus, in the following table, a plus corresponds to the correct identification by the panelists of the different styling heads. In total, the different styling heads from the triad was correctly identified 20 times out of 30. The triangular test thus indicates, according to ISO 4120, that a difference is perceivable between a styling head that is shampooed only and a styling head that is shampooed and then fed by oil. Then, a difference having been perceived, an olfactory profile was carried out in order to explain this difference. The difference, therefore, seems to be explained by a higher olfactory intensity on the hair treated with the nutritive oil, which corresponds to what we wanted to demonstrate. It will also be observed that the nutritive oil also brings olfactory notes of fat type, which may contribute to the difference. The following case studies deal with deodorant type products. The performance of deodorants is a major asset in meeting customer expectations and finding a place in this highly competitive market. When developing new formulas or deodorant actives, it can be interesting to make preliminary screening to determine the best prototype. To do this, SenseNet has developed in vitro deodorant efficacy protocols, saving time and money at this stage of product development. The active ingredient or formula to be tested is brought into contact with artificial sweat and/or the main chemical compounds in the sweat. If the active ingredient aims a bacterial action, in vitro tests may include the generation of odors by the action of bacteria on compounds of interest in sweat. It can be triglyceride or fatty acid, for example, for a defined period and under controlled condition. The intensity of the malodor and/or the concentration of the odor can be evaluated and compared with a control sample. The best selected prototype can then be assessed by in vivo efficacy tests to generate data to support the claim. Here we have a case study of the selection from 7 mineral agents of the mineral agent that provides the best sweat odor reduction. For the sampling, each mineral was introduced in the same quantity into a container to which a defined volume of artificial sweat was applied. This container was then placed in a cellophane bag and placed in an oven at 32 degrees for 2 hours and then 24 hours before the odor concentration was analyzed. A control containing only artificial sweat was sampled under the same conditions. The results are shown opposite with the sweat concentration values alone on the left. After 2 hours of contact, the mineral D is the one that provides the best reduction in sweat odor, with a reduction of 72% under test condition. After 24 hours of contact, the best reduction is offered by mineral F, with a reduction rate of 92%. Mineral F was then introduced into a deodorant formulation for in vivo evaluation. For in vivo tests, SenseNet follows the requirements and recommendations of the ISTM 1207. We typically work with a panel of 20 to 30 volunteers using an indirect method. That is, after application of the product and a placebo randomly under the armpits, sweat is collected on pads worn for several hours. These pads are then collected in jars and are then evaluated by six panelists trained to quantify the olfactory intensity of sweat on a scale of 0 to 5. This indirect method makes it possible to avoid the subjectivity that can be induced by the volunteer's armpit vision. If the products to be tested also have antiperspirant properties, an in vivo test by gravimetric measurement of the pads according to FDA modograph guidelines can be carried out at the same time as the deodorant study. The various claims highlighted in the different case studies can be supported by a SenseNet Trust Seal. The Trust Seal allows to demonstrate that the tests have been carried out by an expert and independent laboratory under standardized and controlled conditions. A validation report of these claims can be put online for consultation by customers or consumers. For more information on this Trust Seal, please visit our website. To conclude now this webinar, we can say that the case studies have highlighted the fact that sensory and molecular analysis can help at every stage of product development. The sampling step is crucial. Sampling should be as close as possible to the actual use of the product. High standardization at every stage of the odor measurement process is the key to reliable and repeatable results. The choice of in vitro or in vivo test depends on the objectives and the stage of development of the product. The case studies have also shown that the evaluation of odors by the panelists is quick and allows the capture of sensory information based on human perception. Molecular analysis provides a detailed understanding of the main odorant molecules present in the headspace of the products. Don't hesitate if you have any questions or if you want to know more to contact me by email or by phone. You can find my details on this slide. You can also book a session with one of our consultants. You will find on our website a form to book a 15-minute slot for an exchange in English, French, Spanish, or Portuguese. You can also visit our social media to follow our news and events. Thank you for your attention and your participation to this webinar, and I hope to exchange with you very soon. I wish you an excellent day and see you soon.